You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and hello and welcome. That just sums up our podcasting journey so far. Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always, Billy. I am joined for the sixth official time on the SWN podcast. It's Frozen Empire, because hell is frozen over. He is back. He is a wrestler once again. Well, he will be in, when this goes out, 3 days, four days, something like 3 days. It is once again the possibly red-haired warrior, but we don't know quite yet.
I'm saying nothing. Hello, Billy. It's good to be back. I like how you managed to make the title work. Causing it Frozen Empire just because I like Ghostbusters, but then actually being able to, in light of recent events.
Well, to be honest, that was like half the reason I gave
making
you a
it work. Top wrestling journalist in Scotland.
I hate the internet just froze for a moment there, and all I heard was top internet journalist. I'm assuming it's about me. The old Billy Melt, some may call me.
Billy Meltzer. How are you? How are you doing?
I'm doing good. It's been a very busy couple days. I mean, when this goes out, I will have been we've done Mac Murray, the music festival that's up here. Then I would have done. I've got a recording in live in Aberdeen on Monday.
Very interesting.
It's not been announced as yet. I haven't even put it on Patreon yet because I feel like it's one of those things. If I do announce it, it's not going to happen. And then I've got a recording Tuesday, Wednesday, and then it's pray to God my laptop has survived, and it might not after this particular chat because the storage is quite low at the moment, and like I say, our past precedes us when it comes to
what we'll do, Billy, to help you out with all this technology and all this content you're doing. We'll do the podcast now. Obviously, we're recording now. We'll do half an hour, then we'll call it a day.
That's it. Yeah. I don't think we can ever. I'm going to ask you. I haven't asked you really a question yet, and we're already like 5 minutes or so in. Do well. How are you doing? You're no longer a civilian.
I'm no longer a civilian. Hell has frozen over. I'm now going into Aberdeen Anarchy as a part of Sterling Oil. What the fuck? That's your first F-bomb. What is going on? Couldn't have predicted that. And yeah, like again, Aberdeen Anarchy is going to be, from what I'm hearing, is going to be very, very busy. The hall is being opened up because we need more space, which is brilliant. More space to have a street fight.
Yeah, there is that. We'll get into the full car properly, but yeah, the whole Sterling Oil thing. I watched the video went out yesterday, with your manager for the evening, Mr.
That's bizarre. You even saying that? He's back. He's my manager. How did we get here?
To think, what was it, 2018, that we had Rashtar Russell at war with Damien as well, and it's just it's a bizarre world, as to coin a phrase. It's just, yeah, so weird looking at it. Especially, like, if it was just yourself, William, and Damien, and no other kind of name connotation to go with it. All right, a bit odd, anyway. But the fact that it's going under the Sterling Oil banner as well just makes it feel... makes it feel unknown. Especially, what, the 12 years I've been going to... No, 11 years. 11 years I've been going to WrestleZone shows, to think that you guys are going to be under that Sterling Oil banner. That's just... Yeah, mind blowing in a weird way. and you're doing it, I'm just gonna be watching it.
I'm doing it. Hey, the foundation of the future are everything that they claim they are. So why tarnish it all by putting your hands in the ring announcer? I've got. I wasn't able to get everything off my chest. The video that recently went up. I think I might need to do something in my own time, because lots of people are talking about pulling back the curtains, but you know, let's pull back the curtains and tell people what the truth is. It's like, well, I've got some truth bombs. Mm-hmm. I've got truth bullets I want to throw at people. And I think I might need to do it on my own time and not like infringe upon the WrestleZone's official Facebook feed and pollute it with me speaking for 15 minutes or something stupid. I might do it on my own time. I might do it on Sunday. I'm pretty fired up. And I think before we get to Anarchy, I think I need to let off some steam before we really let all the steam out of Anarchy. And it isn't just a street fight. It's like you said, the whole card. I think there's still a match to be announced. Pretty sure. I've heard rumblings. I'm not going to say anything because, you know, I might jinx it. But if what I hear is true, it's an absolute belter. And I don't want to ruin it for you because you'll be really excited. So I think
as of now, like maybe an hour ago, a video went out on a possible match that's going to happen. It's been offered anyway. That's just the way that it's been put. It's been offered out. So I think that leaves everything bar the pre-show. So by the time this one actually comes out, I will have done the WrestleZone podcast thing, and it will all be announced and hopefully a full card. This is a year. As soon as I saw the t-shirt, I thought, yeah, I'm going to get one of those as well. So I'm very excited for Anarchy. I don't think I've bought an Anarchy t-shirt since the first one I went to, but I don't know why I haven't, because it's a nice little keepsake that I feel like I should have picked up each year. But
I think I ended up with three of them, and I don't know how. I don't know. So I mean, Neil, if you want a spare Anarchy shirt, I'm sure I've got one kicking about.
I will take any. But yeah, it's I have a first one. I've still got the first one, 2013. It might still fit me, which is a miracle in itself. Because I've seen photos of myself from 2013, I shouldn't be able to fit. Although I've still got the first ever Aspen t-shirt I got was large, and it still fits. Might not look pretty on me, but it still fits. There's a little bit more rollage than it needs to be. But Gildan Soft, I like looking at the t-shirt designs. If people put Gildan Soft in there, I'm going, that's fine, I can go large and make myself feel thin for a moment. So it's been about a year since we last actually had you on this podcast.
Has it been that long? Yeah, I was trying to remember.
I think so. I think it's 11 months on YouTube, but it could be either side of the month. So by that point, you were properly a civilian. You're no longer Scotty Swift. It was like serendipitous. There's a word. It was called the real Scotty Swift, because we did it for real Ghostbusters. So it seems like when we do these chats, it just works in nicely for my little theming of Ghostbusters themes. I don't know what the next one's going to be, if they make another one. But
even in the pod, we're telling stories. What I said about telling stories, Billy, and I like to tell stories. I like to make moments. We're just telling stories on the podcast as well. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful thing.
That's why I like having you on. I mean, it's been. I think you've skipped a season now, but because we needed to get the reason for Frozen Empire, that's why we've done it. So even better. I'm just pulling up the card for Aberdeen Anarchy while I was trying to, but I've got myself distracted by chatting with you, which is what a professional should actually do, because I'm a professional podcaster. So there's five matches official, one more that's been announced offered tonight, and then we'll have the pre-show, which I have an idea. And again, that's just me, wild predictions. And when it comes to WrestleZone, my predictions are terrible, to be honest. They're awful. I don't know. You wouldn't have seen my face at Regal Rumble because you were chucked out by that point. But apparently I had a face of thunder when Caleb won, just because I was wrong, more than anything else.
So you were happy that Caleb won, but you weren't happy that you got your prediction incorrect. Okay.
Yes, that was pretty much it. I was very happy that Caleb won, but then I had to endure about 10 minutes of Kelly next to me going, ha, 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 when Ronan went out. So it was tainted just for that brief moment of going, oh, Jesus, I'm wrong. And she's going to be right. She's going to do this all the way home. And it made sense because last year I did the same when at the main event of Anarchy when I just was really smug about it. And serves me right then.
Yes, but no, we're heading towards Caleb and Aspen part two.
Mm-hmm.
And this is our generation's WrestleMania 6, brother. Title versus title. Warrior Hogan.
I mean, the last time this happened in WrestleZone, you were in the match.
Was I?
It was yourself and Damien for the No Limits and a heavyweight.
Yeah, but that belt doesn't count, no. So I told you already, the belts back then were bullshit.
They count in history. I mean, some of the first couple champions, maybe not. But, When I was putting down the old championship histories on the website, I was like, "Oh, this is an awkward type for the first few." Just going, "Oh God!" But going forward, they've been pretty good. So for yourself, then, do you consider like WrestleZone history kind of started, so to speak, from the beach ballroom onwards, or do you kind of have a starting point in your head for when WrestleZone actually was WrestleZone?
You kind of froze there a wee bit.
Oh, right. So okay.
I only caught the tail end of that.
So, okay. So,
you and your I won't pay anything over £10, he said. Before we started recording.
This is internet issue. This is three, that's the issue. Said, this isn't me.
You're talking about, like, the history. The history of WrestleZone and kind of...
Yeah, where do you consider the starting point?
That's a difficult one because I think we kind of spoke about it before, a wee bit, when WrestleZone was based in Kirkcaldy, then the changeover was made to Aberdeen. I mean, you can officially say, from that point, December 2009. But even then, a lot of the stuff then was, it was a bit shit, to be honest. And it was still like the remnants of just like, we hadn't quite found ourselves. I mean, like, we've got a really strong identity now. And again, that's why it keeps people like yourself coming back because, like, we're not doing, here's the latest wrestling show. There's six matches. No, there's six stories. No, there's six issues. No, there's a cast of characters. And it took us a long time to find our identity. And I think... Like 2012, 2013, we really started. Even 2011, we started to figure out what we are, or what we could be, or what the potential of us could be. And I think, like 2011 onwards, things started rolling a wee bit. Even though you could pick at a lot of it, and some stuff was janky because we're still relatively new in the grand scheme of things. We definitely started to figure out, like, okay, this is our bread and butter. And the first Anarchy show in the ballroom just kind of solidified that we were doing the right thing. So I think, it's a difficult 2008 to 2010 period where it's just a bit, mm-hmm. It's a bit difficult to look at and difficult to think back on. And after that point, we started rolling a little bit. But it's taken us till now to really, all those years behind us of being consistent and figuring out who we are. Like how some I think the wrestling companies that do really well are the ones that clear distinct kind of image of what they are, or even like stylistically, but just there's a sense of, oh, I need to go to the next one because this might happen, or I really enjoyed that, as opposed to just seeing a poster that says live wrestling and you go to the show and it's fine, but you don't think about it again. I like to think that we do shows where people are thinking about it afterwards, which is a difference. like a self-contained wrestling show doesn't move me in any way. Mm-hmm. Like recently, after the changeover with WWE, and I've actually started watching their TV regularly now. I'm actually watching Raw SmackDown again. Mm-hmm. I'm in. No, they got me in because they're. And obviously, it's a much different level to what we are and other companies local. But you know, it doesn't feel like they're being stifled anymore. It feels like people are given a little bit more freedom, and people are getting the chance to express themselves, and people are thinking out the box, and they've got like an identity again that isn't sterile. I mean, obviously, every 5 minutes there's something getting advertised, but hey, it's a business, and that's how you make money. But it feels like we're getting back to, you know, like the kind of wrestling that I want to see. Mm-hmm. And I think WrestleZone is the kind of wrestling that I would like to see. Again, different levels. I'm not comparing us to the big boys because that's mental. We're two different things, but we're totally, totally influenced by the big boys, because how can you not be? And I think the market leaders right now are doing a really good job. I can't remember the last time I watched a whole episode of Raw and SmackDown. It's maybe years. And now I'm actively going out of my way to watch their TV. And then we've got a pay-per-view tomorrow. I was recording tomorrow. They've got the Backlash pay-per-view in France. So it's going to be on a reasonable time that we can watch, which is brilliant. So more of those shows, thank you very much. It seems to be being up to 4 o'clock in the morning. So I'm kind of jazzed for wrestling again. I'm excited for wrestling again. And that sounds daft. You think I'd be excited all the time, but I wasn't. But I'm really, really excited for it.
But I suppose when it comes to like, if you're doing the wrestling, I mean, you've had a little bit of a layoff for reasons we've already discussed, but it's kind of a bit of a busman's holiday. I mean, especially if you're still taking training and that, you're still having to think wrestling as a wrestler or as a professional in some capacity. Whereas be able to watch it again as a fan, and like you say, that's the stories is the most important bit. Which again, that's why I keep coming back, because I know if I hated that I missed Ellen. Because I thought, oh, I'm going to miss something that's going to build up to Aberdeen Anarchy. And that was the reason why I went to, when it was the day last year, the year before, I ended up going to Ellen just because I was like, right, I'm going to miss something if I don't go. And I think this year I'm going to miss Ellen. I think I'm going to miss Hijinks as well. And I'm going to be gutted that I'm going to miss them, because I'm going to miss something that's going to build into the next show. And that's just, I think that's a good sign that I'm sitting there just going, oh, man, I wish I could have went, but you know, other things have to come first sometimes, I suppose. Not many things, but yeah, that's the testament of WrestleZone. And when you're talking about like stories and keep bringing people back, and go back to that Discovery show I went to, there was bits in there that was story based from previous shows, and I was sitting there going, all right, I don't quite understand why this has happened, but I know that everyone in the crowd got into it. So clearly it's something that's been built up a little bit. Mm. There's been a reason for it to happen. And then you just kind of feed off with the rest of the crowd going, okay, right, I'm in. I know what's happening now. I'm in with the flow of this show. And that's what makes you want to come back. And I think, like you're saying, with one-shot shows, and Q3. This is the only thing I actually pay money for, is about three internet, and it's the only thing that doesn't work. It's the one shot thing. It's fine, like I say, it's fine, but it doesn't mean you want to need to buy the ticket for the next one, because you know it's just going to be a card of probably really good wrestling, but there's no reason to come back, kind of thing. So
yeah, I know, I stress, like you're saying, like, I'm not having a shot at it. I'm not having a dig at like a one and done. There's nothing wrong with it. It just doesn't excite me. As you know, like maybe someone sees you maybe once or twice in every year, or maybe they come once every 18 months or whatever, and it's fine. But you know, it's like you get excited, and you know, like, and you get, I mean, as the people who are myself and talking to some of the guys, people who are actually out there doing it, is so much easier to get up for something when you're excited for it. And that sounds like a really obvious thing to say, but you know, a self-contained match is what it is versus, oh, we've got this match on the horizon and it's 2 months from now and this is going to happen and I'm really excited for it, because you got that. So as much as people are anticipating watching it, some of the guys who are in it are anticipating it as much because they're getting jazzed for it too as well. I know I certainly feel that way. Sometimes it's excitement and then it's nerves, you know, because I still get nervous. And then you're worried, I'm going to come through the curtain and then I'm going to forget how to do this, because you get in your own head. And then the moment you come through the curtain, you're immediately okay because it's your brain plays tricks. So yeah, some people aren't wired that way. A few of the guys... feel the same way I do. Could you drop into that character and you are that person now? But yeah, I'm not having a dig at the one and done. I'm just as a guy who's doing it, I'd want more than that. I want to get something I can get my teeth into. I want to get something I can emote with. And people can see the difference, you know. The difference between having a good match and having a match involving a story that genuinely moves people is like one's good and one's incredible, and some people just want to have the good match. Like I've said before, I'm not there to give you the good wrestling match. I want people to feel something because I feel something, and I think that's what we're doing just now. I've had people tell me that it's like, God damn, you guys are fucking telling a story here. And it's like, yeah, we are. And then I'm probably going to die at Anarchy, but that's okay. Do something stupid. Like one of our previous chats, and it said how we are street fights and no DQ matches. I kind of like them. Not all the time and only if they're justified, but when the time is right, you throw in one of those matches, and I'm, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just, I'm there for it.
Just remember to take sandwich Sunday, work this time.
Yeah. and Sunday, I'll be paying for it. Then I'll be cursing myself. It's like, why do I do these things? We're telling stories, though, and, you know, and there's truth. You know, there's a lot of truth. Like I said, I want to film something on my own time potentially this weekend. I want to, because there's a lot of truth. There's so much truth attached to this. And people can read into that, what they think, and people can laugh at that. They're like, well, it's just wrestling. No, there's so much truth about me and the other five guys, and now six, with Russell, Russell's now returned. There's so much truth, and there's so much truth to be told. And I want to. I just didn't want to clog up their feed with my chattering. So I'll clog up my own feed with my chattering. But yeah, again, here's me answering a question that you asked about 10 minutes ago. And I can't remember what the question was. And you just sat there and it's like, I don't know what you're talking about, but I'm going to let you go anyway.
Well, I keep thinking of points to come up with. And then you keep going. I was like, I've forgotten what the point was going to be coming out of that. But that's like, all right. I've got it. It's like, I think it was John Cena said recently that he doesn't care about like the five-star matches or anything like that. What he cares about is the reaction of the crowd in that moment. And I think that's the same for me. It's like, I think people have pointed out that if I do a review of a show on the website that I watched on YouTube, it's completely different emotion to when I go to a show live, because I can see what's happening and type along with it. Whereas if I've went to a show live, I have to rely on what I remember and what emotions I felt during that time. And it's a completely different kind of review, because I'm not reviewing the moves, I'm reviewing how I felt. And if I'm doing a show from YouTube, I'm reviewing the show, I'm not reviewing how I felt because I wasn't there. Kind of thing. I watched it retrospectively. So it's that's the bit that's the most important thing for me when it comes to wrestling is the stories. Because I mean, one of my favorite matches going back a little bit is Damien versus Richard R. Russell, and it's a match that wasn't, if you're going to break it down, if I wrote down what happened in that match, nothing happened, you know. but everything happened at an emotional standpoint because that's what you were there for. It was the build up, it was the emotion, we got to see the comeuppance and then all that kind of stuff. That's what that match was for. But if you went, go by it as an analytical standpoint, it was probably crap because nothing happened to it. You know, so it's just all those weird things that wrestling provides. And
the thing is, also with that match in particular, if you were to take it as like an isolated deal, just take the match by yourself, and you were watching it as someone who didn't have any context or hadn't seen anything up to it, they wouldn't appreciate it. But the majority of the people in that building, they did know what went into it. They did understand the context and they knew the people involved. So again, if you take that match and put it in front of people that don't know, it's going to bomb. But if you do it in front of people who do understand and you tell a great story, take them on a great ride, they will go. I mean, I agree with you. I love that match for all the reasons that you've just brought up and everything we're talking about here. But it's all about context. You take out of context. I mean, someone, a match somewhere, you know, oh, Scott, you need to watch this match because it's these two guys. Maybe it's two guys that I haven't seen before. And I think the match is okay. But this person's followed these two guys for X amount of months. And I'm not going to have that like appreciation of it because I haven't followed them. Same deal with that match. You take out of context. And like you said, oh, nothing happened. There's maybe like four moves, you know? But it was great because it was a whole production, and yeah, I love that match. Actually, put me in the mood to watch again. I haven't watched it in a long time.
But when you talk about that in out context stuff, it's like I see a lot of that with AEW. I don't watch AEW. Every time I watch it, every time I try to watch it, they do something that I don't like, and I'm like, nah, I've tried. I'm trying again. But when they're throwing out matches, going, oh, you have to see this match. I'm like, why? You know. Why is this happening? It doesn't happen with everything, but like, why is this happening? Is there a context behind it? Why is this match happening? Oh, they've done this, they've done that. Cool. Right. Okay, I'll go watch it then. But if they go, oh, it's just really two really good wrestlers wrestling. All right. Cool. They're going to do some wrestling for 25 minutes. Peace. You know, I like the emotion. Not being secretive about that. That's how I like my wrestling. Give me a story. Give me a promo. You know, like some of these matches that I've seen online is through social media because I've got the little bits of the characters. I've got the characters that are going into this kind of thing. I'm going, right, okay, it's on YouTube. Sweet, I'll go watch it because now I know the context of the match. I envy folk that can just watch wrestling and just go, cool, throw this match on randomly and watch it. But no, that's just not how I watch it. I need the reason, I need the context for it, but you know, that's just me. That's just some people can do that way, some people can't, which it's one of those things. But anyway, we've kind of, I don't know how we got there. We're here. we veered slightly serious for a moment, which is very weird.
At this moment, I'm gonna try a beer I haven't tried before because I'm gonna celebrate me no longer being a civilian, and you know, lots of bands have gotten on the alcohol train. You know, Iron Maiden and Motorhead. Well, now Feeder have brought out a beer, and I like Feeder. They're one of my favorite bands, so I managed to get a couple of cans. So I haven't tried this yet. So live in the pod, I'm gonna see if I like it.
I've actually seen Feeder. I've seen Feeder at the Ironworks.
It smells. It smells fruity, Billy.
Ooh, I like a fruity beer.
Okay.
This is what people pay their Patreon money for.
Fancy IPA deals, you know. I'm more of a straight ahead beer guy. Well, that's okay, though. It's like, I mean, I'm inclined to give any gimmick beer of like a product or a band or someone that I give a shit about, I'm inclined to at least get one. Mm-hmm. So I've done the Steve Austin, I've done Ghostbusters, I've done Motorhead, I've done Maiden. Just working my way through them all.
Have you got the Cactus Jack one?
Did we... I think I might have had it. I think so.
I was looking for it for ages, but I could never find it. It was supposed to be in Sainsbury's at one point, but I never found it. So I don't want to buy a beer, import a beer in, and then hate it. I feel like that's just like I've wasted my time and money.
Well, it's like I like, you know, like I'm a freak for collecting things, so it's like, oh, at least I've got a nice can.
Fair. I'm on the innocent gun because Brutu never got back to me about sponsorship. Shocking.
I started drinking Innocent Gun because the first Anarchy in with Billy Gunn, and Billy Gunn and Mikey Innes became like fast friends. And we're in Edinburgh one night for a gig. We went to a pub afterwards, and the first time I ever saw Innocent Gun, and I had it on draft. So I took a picture of it and I sent it to Mikey. Said, I'm drinking this solely because it's Innocent Gun. And it's quite nice.
It's not so bad. Yeah. It's not bad. That's my last one from Edinburgh trippy. Because instead of going out, because we're old now, we're in our mid-30s, we just bought a bunch of alcohol from like the Sainsbury's around the corner of the hotel and just got shit faced in our room instead. It was way more fun, to be honest. It was warmer.
You know what? I feel that is that I really need to be in the mood. It's that I've became again. I think I've said this more than once to you. I'm a boning bastard. I'm a boning bastard. Yeah, right. Again, so you know, it's a whole waiting about at 3 o'clock in the morning to get a taxi home. I just don't want to do it. I just don't. I'm not interested in that at all anymore. And I just want my bed. I want to know that I can walk to my bed and it's right there. I'm not a young man anymore.
I think I'm the same when it comes to wrestling shows. I mean, I'm very lucky that I've had folk go, oh, you should come to our show. You should come to our promotion. And I go like, where is it? They tell me where it is. They're like, ah, oh, that's an overnight. I'm just, no, to be honest. I appreciate the offer, but I like to be in my bed. And I like to wake up and see my boy in the morning and that. And if I look at the distance, I'm like, no. Like, at least at Edinburgh, Kelly was down as well. So if anything exciting happened during that week, we're both missing it. So it was fine, but I don't want to like, I just, no, I'm just boring now. I'm just like, no, where is it? Oh, it's within driving distance. I can get home the same night. Yeah, okay, yeah. I'll come. I'll come to the show. But
again, it's also, I mean, obviously, you having the kid now, that's changed all your priorities. I mean, not even before, like, even maybe more inclined to go to a show, have to stay overnight. Not that it makes it any more attractive, but you definitely don't want to do that now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, to go see a show, hey, no, like, it might be all right, or it might be shit.
I know, and if it's shit, you're like, oh, what did I just waste my time doing?
Or it might be really good, but it's just, it's a thought, isn't it? It's like, oh, yeah, got to do that, and then I have this, and then I need to stay here, then that's a thing, and then I need to leave it, this, you know. And it becomes more of a mission and more work than it needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be work, you know, like it should be fun. So I feel that to boring bastards.
Cheers.
Cheers. Innocent Gun. One of my favourite moments from the whole of the first Anarchy at the Ballroom was Billy Gunn and Mikey Innes together. It was great. I loved it.
That's it now. There'll be exceptions to the rule. I went down to Fair City last year. That was good fun. I mean, the travel was an absolute bitch, so that kind of put me off a little bit, but the show was fun. So I kind of cancelled each other out a little bit in that respect, but yeah, I think that was more out of, I enjoyed going, but I think it was more out of like going, oh, some big bald bastard said that I only travel to shows that are within my rail card. So fuck yeah, I'm going to go to Dundee.
Oh, that guy.
Hi.
Right. Okay.
I know. Ironically, I think I'm taking more trains to shows than I ever have before. I mean, one. Maybe two trains, but still, that's more than I've ever taken to go to wrestling shows
because
I can drive. So, yeah. It's just that thought now. And for yourself, I suppose you when it comes to traveling to shows, it's more like gigs. Is traveling, is that your kind of same thought for going to gigs now, or even if we're so inclined to get a outside booking, would that be a would that still be a thought? Just going, no, I'm happy just to do my own thing and then just be able to make it over.
Yeah, I mean, like the whole outside booking thing, because I'm a terribly jaded and cynical person now. So, like, unless it's okay for the people that know me and know what I'm like, but I wouldn't necessarily put anyone else through it. But if I was to get an outside booking somewhere, you know what? It would all depend on, who am I traveling down with? You know, if I was in a car with Caleb and Omar, I'd be like, okay, yeah, I know, that might be good fun. You know, it depends, like if I'm traveling with someone, maybe it'd be a good laugh. I mean, most of the guys, sitting in a car with them, it'd be good fun, just fucking bullshit the whole way there. So is it with gigs? I mean, it's crazy. Martin Clunas and Mickey Vago, seems like they're at a gig every fucking weekend. I can't keep up. Because, I mean, we've got our music-based chat that's still ongoing. And Vago's like, I'm going to that. You know, like, it's all bands that I know. Some of them I like. Some I kind of got... No, they're okay. But he's like, I'm going to that. And Martin's much the same. So it's a... And Caleb can't go to gigs because he's booked solid until, like, December. And I'm not joking.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, this thing may or may not happen was kind of because I messaged Caleb and went, are you free to speak? And he went, no. No, I'm not.
No.
For the foreseeable, I'm just not. And again, he's got a young child as well, so like I'm not gonna insist on taking time from him when I know myself, I don't want to.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Take that time away. So, so again, if that does or doesn't happen, we'll find out by the time this episode goes out. That if it has or hasn't. But yeah, so that was kind of how it all started. Was kind of going, oh, you free? No, oh, okay. And then an idea came into part, and it's kind of snowballed from there, and.
Mm-hmm.
Fingers crossed and all that kind of stuff happens.
But even just stupid little things like us doing like a mosh pit episode, and Caleb won't be free for it because he's away wrestling somewhere. He's booked for the Liverpool Comic Con, which is brilliant. Like, he's booked in Liverpool at a Comic Con. The guy from Montrose is booked in Liverpool for that. That's brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
But it just means he's really, really busy. And he's like, free for that? No, I couldn't do that. No. And Vago was cooking up some idea to get something done in December. And I said, in all seriousness, you may want to try and boot Caleb now. And he's like, this might be doable. And everyone was like, whoa, really? Because he's always doing something. And like you said, I mean, he's married, he's got a child. I mean, he's got his own life. He works as well as doing this. But it's always good to see one of the guys doing well. And like way, 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 way back in the day when he first started, and there's so much potential even back then. And just, it's stupid. I don't think you'll mind me telling this story. It's nothing at all. It's silly. It's just talking about, like, it was one random training session, might have been a Monday, whatever, and whoever was in, a busy night, and Caleb was in. It's still early days for him. And even then, he was pretty jacked and stuff. So I must have speaking about suplexes. I spoke about, like getting someone up for a suplex and then just delaying them there. And I said, oh, no, you could get me for 20 seconds, hold me there. And he's like, oh, I could never do that. Is it get me? And he held him up, and as I'm in the air, I'm counting. And I get a 20, and I said, that's you, and I walked out of the room. Just to prove a point. He's like, oh, it's like, yeah, like, you know, because all the stuff that you have seen on the TV that you don't think you can do most of this, Caleb, and you can. And just little things like that boost the confidence. And they're like, I always remember that. It's like, just grab me and put me up. And off I went for 20 seconds, right. Yeah,
he's so humble as well. Yeah, we're just gonna speak about Caleb for a good comment, son. But he's so humble, and it's ridiculous. Like you said, he's so busy. He's booked everywhere for good reason. Not only is he a very good character. He's got all that kind of thing, but also he's very nice, you know. And that's probably something that you want to have in a locker room. is someone
that's
who
so
is,
important, Billy. Billy, it's so important to be a good person, because that's the kind of people that you want around, and someone would have to be an exceptional talent for them to be an arsehole and people to still want to work with you. Like, it'd have to be like a one in a generation talent for people to put up with your bullshit. And I don't give a fuck how good you are. You're a prick. Get the fuck. I don't care. I'm not interested, because, again, we spoke about wrestling. Oh, I'm a good wrestler. What do you mean? No, what do you mean? Mm-hmm. What is a good match? Again, I know we said before. What's a good match? I don't fucking know. I know what I think a good match is. I think your perception of a good match is my perception of a good match.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? But the fact that you said he's got, like, he invests in himself, he invests in his gear. I don't want to say anything, but I know he's working on music. I'm not saying anything else, but it should be brilliant. And he's a good dude. And he's humble. It's like, you basically just met every criteria as a professional wrestler.
Yeah.
The only thing he's got working against him is he's not 6'4". That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. He isn't particularly tall. And that's not his fault, because you can't do anything about it, because you can't train for height. You are what you are.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not shaming anyone. You can't help. You can work on your body and you can work on your weight, but you can't work on your height. So that's the only thing. He's not been blessed with height. And that's it. And it's not his fault.
But he seems to have, he's like replaced that height with just making the character as big as possible.
Oh, definitely. You know?
So it's just great to see him do well, because as soon as I saw him way back when, muscling about William Sterling, I was like, money. That boy is money. I've seen nothing else other than you just manhandling William Sterling. But as soon as I saw him, I was like, oh, you're money. I'm going to keep an eye where you end up. Yeah. And here he is. However many years later, what, six? Something like 6 years
six,
later?
Six years. Yeah, just, I know what you said, because he's humble, he didn't realize how capable he was until you put him in a position where it was sink or swim, and you knew he was going to swim,
mm-hmm.
and he did. And yeah, it's a beautiful thing, and also when a guy deserves it, you know, are you happy for someone? And there's plenty of guys like that. I mean, Ronan King, what a prick he is. But,
such a prick.
Yeah, he's a prick. Yeah, he's a prick, but he's our prick, you know. And, I mean, it's like, lots of people have helped, but just knowing that you've had some degree of, like, helping someone in any capacity, and then they're doing well, is, like, really good. Mm-hmm. And it keeps you going. As I said about outside booking and stuff, I don't give a shit, really, because...
You're happy.
I'm happy. Yeah, I mean, God, I mean, I'm in a very good position. I really am. And obviously, I'm back now. And whatever that looks like after Anarchy, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Although there will be gala season, so I guess I'll just be jumping about and, in some open day near you soon. But, It just makes you happy to know that, like, you've played some role in it, you know, and, like, yeah, it's rewarding. Like, I enjoy that. Maybe if my role was just, I was just doing shows, maybe I'd be more inclined to do stuff elsewhere, but because I've got a lot going on, I'm happy, man. I'm very happy.
We'll speak about Ronan then, and then, because, yeah, he's another guy that who's just, again, I didn't see his first official match, so the one where he swore at Vago. But you can see there was so much potential there. And again, Ronan King, terrible person, absolute bastard. But he's such a sponge. Like, if we have a podcast with him,
he's just terrible.
But like, when the bell rings at the end of the night, we've done a podcast with him, and he's really, again, he's one of those that it seems to be he's humble until the bell rings or the camera's on, and then he's just an absolute prick about it. But I have the same thoughts about Zach Dynamite. I hate Zach for 3 hours once a month at least, and then after that, I like Zach, but for those 3 hours. I hate him so much. And I've said it to his face as well. I was like, I hate you. But when the show finishes, I like you because you're very good. But you know, those 3 hours, and which is what I'm going to feel on the 11th as well. The street fight. Yeah. Other than, oh God, don't come near me. Don't. Oh shit, they're coming near me. Oh no. Oh no. Oh no. And then other things like that.
I know you mentioned their Ronan's first match was with Mr. P at the Academy, and you can tell from watching that, and it's like, yeah, there's definitely someone here. I mean, he hadn't run it himself; he was still figuring out who he was. It was still very early days, but I know after the match, and Mr. P was like a wee nod of the head, like, yeah. It's like, okay, if Dave's happy, then something good was happening. And I told the story about during lockdown, and I didn't recognize him, and it's like, oh my God, you've just became a grown man. Last time I saw you, you were just a kid. And I like to wind him up because occasionally on my phone, and I'll get like memories pop up, you know, like from my gallery. And I'll get like training videos of like him when he was like, God, I don't know, maybe 16 or whatever, maybe younger than that. Like him and Evan Young and stuff. And they're just like training, you know, like doing drills and stuff. And you want to film stuff so people can see it back and see what they're doing right or see what they're doing wrong. Because often the best way to correct it is to see what you're doing wrong, which is fair. And then these videos are like 5-6 years old at this point, and every now and then one will pop up, and it's just like he's just like all over the place, and it's like looking at a different person. So I'll be sure I'll just send it to him. Is it, you remember this? So stop it, Scott, you're killing me. It's like, could you say on, it's like, what a transformation. I know a lot of the guys have made the jump. I still think some people are just kind of they're umming and ahhing. All it takes is for, you know, for people to make themselves known. Jump in a car with, you know, with a Caleb, or jump in a car with, you know, with like a Ryan Riley, God damn him, you know, and just show face. Something's just showing face, you know. Just show up, we want to help out, or just say, hi, my name is, you know, if you ever need someone, you know, even to say, just take your gear with you. Like, what happens if someone's car's broken down or someone get hurt? I mean, the odds are not in your favor, but these things do happen. I mean, like, life happens. So you just, you know, like a Reese Dawkins, you know, like, I still think Connor Malloy can be, I think Connor Malloy should be everywhere, mm-hmm. to be honest with you. I think he should be everywhere in the same way that Ronan is. You know, I just, Connor got a little glimpse, but it didn't come too much for him, unfortunately. I still hope that changes. Yeah, just make yourself known and show face and make a bit of noise.
That, and I think the social media is the most important. I mean, even though it's a terrible, absolute toxic place to be, but social media is somehow the most imperative thing for that, because I mean, we've got to see Connor now with the big sleigh and all that kind of stuff. He's a bit more bigger on social media now, because he's doing more promos and stuff like that. And I think that's how Ronan kind of broke out as well, not only because he's very talented, because he has that kind of established character, he's able to do things like that. And I mean, think of the names like Ian Skinner as well, being a guy that the reason he's one of the reasons that he got booked so many places in like South England and stuff like that, over the border, was because of this big character you portrayed on social media. And that's how you get to know people nowadays. It's not tape trading anymore. It's GIFs and 2 minute videos on Twitter.
That is a new tape trading, is it? I haven't really thought about that. I'm just like sharing clips and stuff. And it's also quicker because tape trading, you have to wait for tapes to show up in the mail. It can take weeks. And now things are instantaneous. Now you can click on something and watch it straight away. You send it to someone and they get it immediately. So, yeah. And then it's never been easier to ignore stuff because you can just scroll past it. So trying to catch someone's attention is really difficult. But if you get them, then you're doing something right. I said, well, I'm shit at all that. I'm hopeless at that. Omar is quite good at that. Yeah. When me and him were kind of doing our deal, just kind of like, Omar knows what he's doing. He's young and hip. So I'm old with sore hips. So,
you know. But yeah, the likes of Omar, certainly. That's a great shout. Casino Brutal is another one that I really love watching their social media stuff because it just hits the right spot for me. But that's something that, not to be critical of wrestling, I think that's something that they've gotten better at recently. I think before there wasn't as much kind of that social media engagement kind of thing, but I think more recently that there's been more videos and more promos and getting to know characters more and seeing little clips and stuff like that. And I think that, especially if they're trying to fill the whole Rich Energy Arena, that's something that's probably very important to have now is someone seeing it and going, oh, that's the rest, that's cool. They've got a show coming up. Very good to it. Some other promotions don't do anything and they're expecting people to turn up, and it just baffles me. I've got to get results. I don't have to, but I do get results every weekend. And fuck me, trying to find results, it shouldn't be difficult. It should not be difficult. I mean, wrestling's fine. They put up their first half, second half, ace. Target do the same. They put up their results. But the amount of times I have to chase promotions, or they won't give, or I won't get them, they'll blank me out and I'll have to get them from somewhere else. Like, this isn't selling your promotion. This is doing nothing. Why are people coming to your next show if they don't have your last show?
And if you've done a show, then you should be putting results up anyway. You know, like, you shouldn't have to ask for them because they should probably just be good. You could just quickly put them up. This show is happening tonight. You know, I know it's not a big thing, but I always like WrestleZone where they just, you know, they put up an image of the building as they're set up, and maybe they show an image of the first match underway. So it's not results. It's like, teaser, here's the first match, and then halftime, and then, you know, and then we get the rest results and stuff. It just takes a minute or two. It's no biggie. I said it, but shows that are one and done, the shows that are self-contained, the shows that almost wouldn't have existed apart from the people that were there, I don't like that. I agree with that. It's like, it just takes so little effort. It just feels like it's just, oh, it's a show. Yeah, but it could be so much more than that, you know. And it's a creative process, you know. Looking at all these, and it's especially if you get a group of people who are all kind of similarly minded or willing to listen to ideas or get on board with stuff, and they've all kind of got this, they all want the same thing. Because ultimately, in the grand scheme of things, if we boil down to it, we all want the show to be really fucking good.
Yeah.
And when you have essentially everyone with that mindset, these fucking good shit can happen, Billy. So much good shit can happen. And if you just treat it as, oh, it's another show. And sometimes maybe some people it's like that because they're, especially if it's like, if they're like a touring company and they're doing like maybe four nights in a row or something. I don't know. So I understand. But I just think if you're running a show in a place that you return to on a semi-regular basis, we could do something with this, you know? But you having to chase people to find out what happened for their show tonight is a bit silly.
I know.
It's a bit silly.
it's ridiculous at times. This is, I mean, again, it's all stuff that I've put on my own back. Nobody's asked me to do this.
But no, I know.
But still, Cage Match doesn't update itself, does it?
You are officially the feeder system for Cage Match.
It feels like it. It does. Maybe one or two promotions that they somehow nab that before I get them, but generally it goes to me and then it goes to them, and like a few days later. But yeah, it's just mad. But and oh, okay. I can't remember. I think I may have put it online, but I was getting a certain promotion's results when they were doing taped content. That was not fun for anyone. That's how I kind of had to stop putting credit on it, because folk were getting like threats and stuff like that because I was putting out results and I named who sent me them. I just don't understand. I mean, if you're putting out stream content, fair enough. If you're putting out DVDs, okay, fair enough. You don't want to spoil it, or you're putting out streaming content. But like, if you read the results and go, oh, I saw that match sounded really good, or that match was two people that I really liked, I know the result, but I'll watch the rest of the show kind of thing. It's all supposed to be for a good reason. Go, you see the results, you go, oh, I saw that person on that show, sweet, I'll go and watch it. That's how I like to think about it anyway, or at least I try to tell myself that when I'm going, oh, have you got the results for this taped show that's going out in 3 days? I want them now, please, thank you.
That was a really weird period of time, isn't it? That I was just, and we all know who you're talking about. What a fucking shit.
I don't think it added any. I don't think it took away any viewership from their content. We put it out.
Just precious for the sake of being precious. Get over yourself. A little bit. Just, you know. I don't like it. I don't like that either.
We do have some questions, which I was looking at, that we've already hit. We're just about hit an hour already. So we'll get some questions in there.
No, we haven't really said anything.
No, we really haven't. We haven't. I was kind of thinking we're going to go through the Aberdeen Anarchy card. I don't think I'm going to even get there. We might do a couple of the matches, and I'll do that.
I mean, I don't have anything else in my head for this. Just catching up. I'm back.
Like I said,
I'm going to do the wrestling again. Yeah.
Like I said, I wrote your name at the top of a notepad. I didn't say anything else. I thought, fuck, what's the point?
That's literally a Mickey Vago note up, just like the person's name, and that's it. I don't have anything else. Like, okay.
Speaking of, we'll ask a question while these, we'll get through these as well. Okay, so we've got Retro Randy Valentine.
Here we go. Hold on.
Right, it's got two questions. I don't know if they're exactly the same. I don't think
I
they
know
are.
One of them.
So I'll go through the Instagram one first. Then it puts, and I'll quote Scott: "With Dawn of the Dead being hands down the best zombie movie ever, does Day of the Dead deserve second place, or should that go to Video of the Dead?"
No. Well, no. This is all in reaction to the latest episode of the Granite City Horror Podcast. Sorry. If I could say the name of the podcast, it'd be even better. It's been a long day and I'm very tired. That's my excuse. And we covered the Video Dead, and the fake blood in it reminded me of Melted Crayon. And the Melted Crayon look is also the look of the blood in Dawn of the Dead. And Randy got really, really heated about me saying it. Now, that wasn't a dig, it's an observation. And then he gave me the reason why the blood looked like that. And it's like, I know why it looked like that. You don't need to tell me, because he seemed to think, because in my opinion, Day of the Dead is the granddaddy of all zombie films. Now, in his opinion, it's Dawn of the Dead. The thing is, Day of the Dead is 10 out of 10. Dawn is like 9.9 for me. It's like, I think it's fucking amazing, right? It's just not my favorite, but he really takes it quite personal. that I say it second best. It's like in way he's acting is like I actively hate on Dawn of the Dead when it's an absolute classic. So this is all centered on something I said, which was observational on the podcast. It wasn't a dig. The blood did look like it looks like melted crayon because they didn't have the formula for fake blood worked out yet, and it was 78, so it didn't, you know, it is what it is. It's fine. So no, Video Dead does not become number two or one or whatever you're saying. Number one is Day of the Dead, and Dawn of the Dead is a very, very, very close second. If anything, is 1A and 1B.
I think that, so, that before we get into the podcast and stuff, he does have a second question about it, which I think you kind of half answered. He's way a bit more formal this time by putting Scotty. What is it that makes Dawn of the Dead such an infinitely better movie than Day of the Dead?
Well, no, it's not infinitely. It's like there's literally very little in it, because Dawn of the Dead is an absolute classic. But Day of the Dead, so here's the thing, because Dawn of the Dead is like a very satirical look at consumerism, and it's a big romp. It's a big party. Like, there's nasty stuff in it too as well, but like it's a whole ton of fun, which is great. But Day of the Dead is like a wholly miserable experience where they're in a bunker, and it's just claustrophobic, and it's miserable, and I really fucking like that because I'm weird as shit. So it depends what you like. You know, are you there for the party and the commentary on society, or are you there to be completely miserable? And as far as zombie movies go, I think the miserable thing works best. But it literally is 10 out of 10 versus 9.9 out of 10. There's very little in it. Randy needs to stop taking this. So here's the thing with Randy, right? Whenever anything pops up on Facebook involving these two films, we will tag each other and play tag war, right? There's like very regularly, there's just arrows thrown across Facebook at each other. And these arrows will stop when Randy accepts that Day is the best and Dawn's a very, very close second.
So speaking of then zombie films or what have you, the Garry City podcast, horror podcast.
There you go.
If I get it right as well, that'd be good. So you've turned your hand to podcasting. You've become one of us podcasters.
One of us.
How we talked about as almost unsolicited opinions coming through. How's other than the tech issues, how has the podcast journey gone so far for you?
Well, it's just like here's the thing. It's like, I mean, without getting, it's one of those things where myself and I say we do. It's like it's not a co-host. It's two hosts. So the other host, Bill, William Sterling,
Buell.
Again, everything comes full circle, and now we're teaming with each other. It's worked out quite nicely. We're a podcast tag team and now we're a wrestling tag team, so it actually worked out really well. Everything becomes like real life imitates art and etc. A lot of everything that we did was tied to wrestling, and that's fine, but you know, we got other stuff that we like, and he brought up, and he's just like, nice to have other outlet that isn't wrestling. Do you want to do a horror podcast? It's like, yeah, fuck, I'll do that. So after spending hundreds of pounds on equipment that didn't work, and it's like, what? We finally managed to get something. Every time we sit up, he struggles to sit up because we do it at his home. And he struggles to set it up, and it's like, I should know by now. It's like, you should know by now. And I said, we need to put a camera just filming him trying to set up and just put it up as bonus content because it'd be a riot. I've only done like 12. I haven't, because it's not every week. It's just like every 3 weeks, so it averages out, you know. generally they'll go half an hour to an hour, depending on. And that's the amazing thing, is keeping me under an hour is impressive.
That was incredible. When I saw the runtime for the first one, I was like, how?
It just depends, because some films you can blitz through and you're done, and then some, like, it's always the films that aren't particularly good, or they're good bad. Because if you get, like, the second Exorcist movie, it's just fucking up with it's horrible. But the episode was incredible, because there's so much to talk about, there's so much to discuss. You know, if you get a film that's really, really good, because this is the thing that we've spoken about, like, I don't want to necessarily do a well-known film disregarded as being good, because what do you talk about? Oh, it's really good. Right, next. Well, it's not interesting. So there's some deep cuts. I like there's films in there that people might not have ever heard of before. They're certainly not the most obvious ones. You know, it might be a franchise-like movie, but, like, it's not the most obvious movie in the franchise, because we need to be fucking awkward. So, yeah, we don't want to do obvious. We want to do deep cuts. We want to do, like, kind of things that are maybe a bit niche, or, and also films that we personally like a lot. So, yeah, we've only done, like, 12 of them. But it will never run out. No, no, this will only stop if we decide that we want to stop it. Because there's so much content. There's so much films out there. Like, there's a couple of films that I suggested that he never heard of. A couple of films he suggested that I hadn't seen before. So even between us doing this, we're now seeing stuff that we haven't seen before. And we're only 12 deep. So, and the next one we've got lined up is an absolute belter. I don't think you'd like it, but you can prove me wrong. It's fucking weird. But yeah, we've got a group chat named after this film and the last film we did. Because the last film that we did gets quoted on a regular basis. I don't love the film. I love the fact that Buell loves it. His love of the film makes me happy. The film doesn't necessarily make me happy, but the fact that it makes him happy makes me really happy. So I love it by association, but I don't really love it. Mm-hmm. It's a very weird relationship.
I think I'm kind of in the same boat with listening, because horror films just not my bag. It's just it no. Never has been, never will be. But I do listen to the Gareth Say Horror podcast, because I like how you guys are so passionate about speaking about it. You know, it's just like okay, these guys are. They're into it. I'm enjoying listening to it, but yeah, I have no intention of watching these films, because it's just not my genre of wrestling. Genre of film. God, yeah. So it's just not my thing. But hearing you guys speak about it, it just I can hear the passion. I can hear why you guys like it. Like, cool. That's fine. It's nice.
Listening to people talk about things that aren't necessarily your thing, but you appreciate the fact that they care. Because I think this may sound like a really arsey thing to say, but I don't care, because it's me. Fuck. But I always, like, I'm very distrustful of people who don't have something. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You know, like it's not something that gets you really excited. Or geeking out. Like, I'm a big fucking nerd. I know I am. Most of my friends are big fucking nerds. Then we get into discussions and debates about stuff, and like, have you seen that? Have you seen this? What about that? Oh, I don't like that. Well, why don't you like that? You know, when people don't have something like that, it just puts me off. And it's like, there's something wrong with you that isn't quite right. It's like, what do you mean you don't like? Oh, I don't like music, or I don't like movies, or I don't like games. It's like, what do you mean you don't like anything? What do you mean? It's like, that doesn't compute with me. Mm-hmm. How can you not like something? What gets you excited? What gets you motivated? No, like, what gets you spending stupid money on shit you don't fucking need? What is it? And when people don't have that, it just is, I find it really off-putting. Like, there's something wrong. I don't know what that says about me, but that's how I feel.
I get that. I mean, for me, it's probably Marvel films. That's probably my thing. Surprise, surprise, as I've got a Mjolnir sitting behind over my shoulder. But yeah, that's the thing I like outside of wrestling. That's the thing. I think I saw a couple of tweets about it from other wrestlers going, if you're a fan and you revolve your life solely on wrestling, please find something else as well, because you shouldn't just revolve around one thing. But yeah,
me and Vigo spoke about that during one of the lockdowns about not having anything other than wrestling, and some people fucked it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and yeah, you need to have. I think it's healthy to have something. And again, and it just goes what you asked about the podcast. There's the fact that we're doing it in the first place. Is stemming from, you know, there's other shit that we like that we can collectively work together on. Mm-hmm. So why not, let's do this? You know, we might branch off into other films or like not like horror films, but you know, kind of like cult niche films. There's a handful already in my head there now that would just be incredible to do. A few of which I don't think Buell's seen, so I'll expose them to some wondrous stuff. But it's been fun, but nowhere near the amount of work that you're putting in. Because I just rock up at his house and we do it. I'll generally watch the film, whether I've seen it before. I like to watch it the night before recording, so it's fresh in my head. Generally, I'll go into the guts of things, like detail stuff, but then often we will literally have the exact same notes, like check sections of our notes will be identical, and it's like, it's fucking freaky. He's like, yeah, this is exactly the same thing I've just written down as you. So we're basically finishing each other's sentences here. Yeah, because there's very obvious things in these films, like, remember this bit? Yeah. How about that bit? Is it, that was fucking mental, but how about that bit? So, yeah, I just rock up at his house and we just record it and I go home again. So...
Gosh, you make it sound like I do a lot of work. I really don't. I sent you the link today, but I make it look like I do a lot of work. I'm very good at making myself look busy. It's worked for, how long have I worked at my current job? 16 years. I've been very good at making myself look busy. So yeah, generally, I sent you a link on Wednesday for this chat. I sent it to you today on Friday. And and then pretty much what I'm going to do is I'm going to wait for the file to load up, put it into my Google Drive, send it to my laptop, top tail it, done. I do nothing. I hear these podcasters go, oh, I did the balance of the sound and the levels. Like, I did none of that. None of it at all. No, I've done. I go into my microphone here. I put auto. That's it. That is done all automatically. Sure, I could probably make a million views in that if I did. If I actually did some editing. Nah, I'm all right. I'm cool with what I do. That's fine. I'll do three of these a week. Oh, that's good. That's fine. I don't really.
I have been misled. I have been hoodwinked. I've been bamboozled.
Ken, I was looking at Vagos and Vago put up a wee picture on his Twitter of like his like screen of him editing shit, and I'm looking at it going, hey, fuck all that. I do nothing to this. Oh, he's got like nice little logo in the corner. But you know, YouTube does that if you set it as your brand. That's it. I don't need to do that, so that's fine. I've worked very well on very little to get to this level of where I am. I don't understand it. I'm much too afraid to. If I see podcasters talking about things, I'm just like, I know nothing about that. I've got Zoom. I paid for Zoom. That's it. That's pretty much all I've paid for when it comes to this.
You're nothing but a hack fraud.
I really am. I have had people like Vigo even mentioned, like when he was setting up the wash pit, he asked me some questions about it. I was just like blank. I'm going, I don't know. Got Zoom, got microphone. Even then, the first one was Omar. The first ever episode with Omar. I had a £1 pair of headphones and Zoom on this laptop, which is probably older than, I don't know, most trainees nowadays. And that was it in my kitchen. That was it. And nowadays, I'm in my office, my box room here. And use a desktop, isn't mine, it's my work computer. And that's it. So it's podcasters that are doing all this effort. don't. You don't need to. It's fine. It's just, like, be lazy.
Wow.
He says when the YouTube algorithm has screwed him royally and all my listenership is going through the audio feed so people don't look at me anymore. I what do I know?
Really? Is that what's happening? Yeah?
Yeah, so the YouTube doesn't look good when it comes to it, but every episode that I've put out since late last year, it's at least 100 listens. At least. But the video barely scrapes 20 if I'm lucky. I don't know why. But shorts, the wee YouTube shorts like TikTok, that hits a good couple hundred if I'm lucky. But yeah, I don't know what's happened to YouTube. Maybe I should actually make some effort with the YouTube. That might help me. But all my contents, all my listens are driving through the audio instead. So, which makes it really awkward when I'm trying to get big guests on when they go, they have a wee Google and check and my YouTube numbers are shite. That audio is fantastic.
Yeah, one thing. It'd be difficult to get people on board, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I'll ever get them, but I contacted Mr. Anderson. Just for balls. You know, I just thought, fuck it, why not? And he came back to me, in fairness, and he went, can you send me a link to your podcast? I was like, oh, shit, I'm going to send you my YouTube link, and it's going to look awful. And that was the last contact I had with Mr. Anderson. Anderson. So... But, you know, at least came back to me. I quite like that. At least I was like, oh, cool. You're one of my favorites growing up. And now you're actually... I think that's why I haven't got Gangrel. That's what I'm going to tell myself. I'll confront him at Anarchy. That's it. I'll go, here is my £15. Yeah, I'll take a picture with you. How dare you not be on my podcast. Anyway. So, yeah.
Eno Vigo joked about getting Gangrel on the mosh pit.
I would genuinely be furious if he got a mother wash pit.
I know you would.
I it would be unreasonably furious as well because we'd be like, oh, that's really cool. Fuck you, Vago. At the same time. So he's got a couple of folk that I haven't had on yet from WrestleZone, and I think one or two of them I probably will never get from listening to the episodes. But you know.
Are you talking about Ted O'Keefe?
They may be talking about Ted O'Keefe. I like Ted. I have no reason to dislike Ted. He does not like me. And that's just the way it is. So I'll just live with it. We'll just have the wee awkward handshake as we have at every WrestleZone show. But, you know, I have no issues with him. I really don't. I missed a couple tweets that he sent me. I did put up a picture, right, so he moaned about it. I'll just talk about it now. But yeah, he moaned about me not putting up a picture with him and Murphy that I got at Granite City Showdown. So he moaned about it. I didn't put it up because I spent the next 3 days really fucking ill. So I looked like shit in that picture when I took it. So I was like, I'm going to put that up because I look like utter shit. And secondly, I did put it on Facebook, but he's not a friend of mine on Facebook, so he didn't see it. Sometimes I don't put pictures up. It's just... Don't take it personally. It's fine. Don't worry. Don't worry about it.
No. When I see him at Anarchy, I will explain the whole situation that you were just ill.
I put it up afterwards after I listened to the episode. Put up the picture. And I tagged him in it. And he has not responded. So we'll make Aberdeen Anarchy nice and awkward during the meet and greet sections and all that kind of stuff. I don't know. But yeah, honestly, I have no issues with Ted. I just find it funny that he seems to have an issue with me. But we'll just move on from that point onwards. Because I know that there's some wrestlers who don't like me. I don't know why. Because I feel like I'm a fairly positive person when it comes to wrestling. But some people don't like positivity, clearly.
When we come off a year, send me the list of all the people that hate you.
Oh, I think it's mostly people that work through one particular promotion. I think I may have spoken about it at the time. When I assumed I got blacklisted at one point because every time I tried to contact someone, they got a booking for a promotion and it suddenly stopped replying to me. I was like, I think somebody is telling you not to do this particular thing. I don't think we do anything fucking bad on this podcast. Everyone's really like professional on this generally until we do episodes for yourself. And then we just fucking go wild. I don't get it. I don't understand it. It makes me paranoid at times as well. But like, Why? It's just a shitty. I'm not going to put down my own podcast. It's a very good podcast, but it's just a podcast. Get over it. Get over it.
Some people are just criminally. No, they're just so insecure. You know, and I don't know what goes through their mind. Yeah, I mean, like, you're a fan doing a podcast and doing your website. It's something that you enjoy. Mm-hmm. And some people just take shit too serious or too personal, or they think that you're more than what you are.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's or it. Is this like an excuse to have a go at you? Or I don't know.
Oh, had that as well. Live on a podcast. I've had someone have a go at me. That's like
live on a podcast.
On a podcast. Yeah, I'll send you a link to it.
Okay.
It's never happened before. I didn't know how to really react to it. It's like I'm just doing this for my own enjoyment. I think people think that I'm going to be like, oh, give me free tickets and all that. If you want to, I will absolutely take them. But I'll never ask. I'll never like go, oh, I'm doing this podcast. Can I come in for free? Because even when I did a couple bits of Inverurie, I still bought my ticket for Inverurie. I was going to that show anyway, but they were kind enough to let me do a couple filming bits before the show. But I still bought my ticket. Mm. I have no assumption that I get into a show for free. I still buy my ticket. So that being said, though, if anyone wants to give me a free ticket, I will take it. I will take it with two hands and gladly. But anyway. I think people think I'm a bigger... They think I'm a bigger deal, whereas... I don't like speaking to people face to face, so I can't really be a big deal because I'm terrified of human contact. So, anyway, right, more questions. I've done meet and greets at the Wrestling Zone shows. We've met each other. It's a very awkward.
Yeah.
And it's
not for me. No, it wasn't awkward for me. I was happy to meet you.
I feel very awkward at them. That's just how I am as a human, in general. So. I can't wait to meet Gangrel. That's going to be fun.
he's a lovely man, don't worry.
Hopefully I can do better than when I met Billy Gunn and said even, I liked him. I can't remember what the quote was now, but I liked everything he done. Even, I think it was even the smoking guns, I said. Insanely cruel. And Lita, of course, saying that...
Oh, I was going to say, my favourite's Lita. It's the picture that I'm not going to sell on eBay, so now she thinks you're going to... Well done, Billy.
It was a bit before it when she admired my Hardy Boys t-shirt. I went, oh, I got this off eBay. I couldn't find one of yours.
Just don't even mention it. It's fine.
I know. I'm so glad I did a Google search because I thought Gangrel had won the European title, so I was going to take my European belt. I thought that would... I Googled it. So I thought, I'm not sure if he actually won it. He didn't win it. I thought, fuck, because that could have been really weird if I just turned
I
up with it.
I thought he did. Did he not win? No.
No, he had a European title match against X-Pac.
Was it the Rumble?
I can't remember. I think maybe Rumble 99. I'm going to check Gangrel.
Because they
weren't
Rumble 99.
I'm going to do the search now. It turns out he was a European champion. I'm going to look like a right army. Yep, that's it. Gangrel was originally supposed to win the WWE European title at Royal Rumble 1999. But he never actually won it. So... That's saved me an awkward moment of me turning up with it.
You signed this belt. If you want me to, I don't know why, but okay.
It's like that Mandela effect thing. It's just like, I was positive that he was a champion. I just never was. I can go next to my Hacksaw Jim Duggan signed WWF Tag Team Championship because he asked me if he wanted me to sign it. I went,
you know what, okay. To say no?
It's like, okay, here you go.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
I know, I'm terrible speaking to wrestlers. Discovery recently, I got a wee signed trading card from Leon Slater. Got a picture with him. I wandered off. He had to come and get me to give me my card because I forgot it. I just wandered off after getting the picture with him. I'm fucking liability at shows, to be honest.
You're just very awkward, aren't you?
Yeah, so I'm happy just to sit at least two or three rows back. Let me watch wrestling, and then I will leave quietly. Don't worry, I will. I won't bother anyone. It's okay. Anyway, more questions.
No, that's the way to do it. Come to a show, cause no trouble, leave quietly, go home. Fine, absolutely fine.
I know, last wrestlers, two shows you've been at, you've scrapped with the wrestlers, so bringing it back on topic.
I was justified. Well, I didn't scrap with the first. Well, I kind of did a little bit, yeah.
So back to the question, I suppose. Okay. We have the Asian sensation, Omar Muhammad.
Uh-oh.
Not Umar. Please, wrestlers.
Yeah.
And fans, please stop calling him Umar. Because I don't think Omar cares particularly, but it really annoys me. It itches that thing that just goes, no, you're wrong. Ask Scotty if he still has that Shirani and scarf.
I do. I'm actually looking at it right now. It's right over there. And obviously me pointing there means nothing, especially if this is audio.
Where which most mileage of the script gets, yes.
It's the only thing that gets traction. For people who are listening, I'm pointing to the top right. It's right across from my Ghostbusters Lego firehouse that's never been built. It's right there. I've still got it. And you know what? I'd like to get a chance to wear it again. That'd be nice.
Gala season coming up.
We had it and they got interrupted. Yeah, like my favorite tag team partner of all time was Omar Muhammad, so I'd like to bring that back. That'd be nice.
Where does Jay Lethal rank in that?
He'd be higher if it's more than one match.
True. Fair enough. It's
Omar and it's Johnny Lyons.
Fair.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Also ask him if he really needed that Ecto-1 from Target.
So with the Frozen Empire being out and the rollout for merchandise was a bit tame, which I was disappointed about but also relieved because I don't have a lot of room. So it's like, because I already had a plan of how to make room, but then I thought, well, that's fine, I won't have to now, it's fine. But there was some stuff, but it's hard to get a hold of here. So at the time the movie's out in cinemas, Omar's went on holiday and he's like, I'll keep an eye out for you. Okay. So he's found stuff. He's in Target and he's found some stuff. That same weekend, I went into HMV just on a whim for a look and it had three out of the five pops I needed. So right, so now I've got enough for a shelf. So now I'm going to have to make room for a shelf for stuff connected to the new film, because now, because of myself and stuff, and Omar being nice enough on the travels, which I paid him for everything, I sent the money right away, but he was in Target, and he's like, oh, they've got the Ecto-1, okay, and I said, I don't really need that one, and he's like, are you sure, and I went, no, I'm not, he's like, well, I get it, yeah, so he got me that as well, so, yeah, I didn't really need it, but I needed it. But it is the new Ecto, but there's not a big difference. But I'm a sad bastard, so I'm gonna have to make room for that too as well. So I'm gonna end up with a shelf now for this new movie, after telling myself I wouldn't have to. So Omar's partly to blame for me having it, but also I could just say no. But I'm incapable of saying no because I've got no willpower.
Because you come back and you just every time you look at him, you just go, you should have just got it. You shouldn't have believed me. You should have just got it anyway. If you're a real friend, you would have just got me.
Yes, correct.
So we do have actually wrestling questions as well. So we'll go through them with Callum Bruce. He's put, right, so he's got loads, as he always does. How was ghostbusting or whatever happened during retirement?
Oh, it's ghostbusting or whatever happened during retirement. I mean, just like retirement in general. I mean, I was still connected to it with the academy. I mean, I wasn't around with shows and stuff, but I was still doing it, helping. Just not getting a chance to get in there in front of people, but it was good, and then it was difficult. And then I got my head around it and I keep my terms with it. And then the shit hit the fan with the Foundation of the Future and now I'm back. And it's like, oh, okay, well, I guess I don't need to worry about dealing with it anymore. Because apparently, and again, I don't know what this looks like after Anarchy. I don't think Sterling All is going to be a permanent deal. I think it's a one and done. But retirement was fine, then difficult, then fine again, and now it's done. So yeah. And no ghost busting, because I mean, I don't have the license to carry the official, a proper ghost busting equipment. It's pretty dangerous, apparently. So
yeah, I hear if you cross the streams something.
And they can't do that. It'd be bad. Yeah.
What did you think of Mr. WrestleZone's work with Omar?
Work. You know what? I don't know how old that guy was, but he behaved like a big kid. So let's say, I mean, okay, he's ageless, but he's not like a big kid. I don't know what his motivation was, apart from the fact he just wanted to be a wrestler. But there's a lot of really competitive, intense, angry men in wrestling and women. And I think it's okay for someone to come in and just try and make people smile, make people laugh, even if it is at the expense of a couple of wallies. I know Omar wasn't there. He wasn't particularly impressed with a lot of his antics. He had a crack in arse, though.
So he said.
For what I can gather, is apparently only on selected events was his arse big. I don't know how that works.
I did see a slightly inflated one at allegedly inflated one at Christmas Chaos. I do seem to remember that, and then that was the last time I saw Mr. WrestleZone, so I don't know if it was connected at all. Maybe it was some sort of jealousy from the foundation that saw his massive arse.
I don't know. Yeah, you may have to ask. Callum might need to ask Omar about his feelings for Mr. WrestleZone, but I just, like, someone who wanted to achieve his dream and did it to a point. Just a bit of a liability, though, was he? He was a bit of a liability.
He was a wee bit. I still can't forget Martin's face at Aberdeen Anarchy last year when he was watching Mr. WrestleZone with the elongated tag rope and then got tangled in the elongated tag rope. And I don't think I've ever seen Martin crack fully at a show. Like, I've seen him like laugh or smirk, but I think I was just watching him dying, laughing at Mr. WrestleZone trying to get out of this tag rope situation, which it was a nice little bit of just a moment watching all of it unfold. It was untangled, so to speak. It was an interesting period of Mr. WrestleZone, and yeah, he brought fun to wrestling. And I think that's all you can hope for.
I don't think it needs to be serious all the time. I think there's a space for, I don't know if this is his motivation for behaving the way he was, but I think there's a place for fun. We shouldn't forget that, like, you know, it's meant to be, you know, like a form of entertainment. So I think some of us are guilty of getting ourselves so worked up in such a way that we kind of lose sight of what it can and should be sometimes. And I think it's meant to be entertaining. That's the whole point of it. So that's my take on it. Never met the guy. He tried to contact me on Facebook at inappropriate times of the day and morning, but never met the guy. Would I like to meet him? You're okay.
I mean, speaking of awkward interactions, he immediately pointed me at Aberdeen Anarchy last year and said, I've seen you on the internet. That automatically terrified me for a good couple of seconds.
That's like a suitably vague statement. The internet's quite a vast place. So what do you mean by that?
Yeah, so that was like immediately. It's like, I know I've done nothing really bad on the internet, but immediately I thought, have I actually done something bad on the internet?
Apart from when you work with SWE, you haven't really got anything on the online that's questionable.
Sorry, it's barely online. I think I've still got just like the only four photos I'm in, so it's all good. It's fine. It's probably the biggest crowds that they've had recently. So I mean, from True. Pictures that I've seen, I mean, Jesus, if you're going to put out a picture of your ring and all that, don't put a picture of single line crowds. That's just sad to look at. I've had one beer and I'm wild and crazy. Right, okay.
He's out of control already, ladies and gentlemen.
Out of control. If you want to hear my full thoughts, go to the K&K Wrestle Factory where I had like six beers and just started going, fuck it, I don't care anymore. And Mickey Vago's podcast, the lowest, I think it's the lowest listened to podcast. Check that out. Award winning. So Calum's also asked, if you are the third man, does that mean, oh God, I'll try to read this now. If you are the third man, does mean the acknowledgement of Scotty Swift being the Hulk Hogan / John Cena, i.e. the major face of WrestleZone?
Nah. Well, I mean, in that context, Hogan did dirty on Luger and Savage, didn't he?
Yeah,
I have no intention of doing an anarchy. Any comparison to Cena is welcomed. Thank you.
all Don Cena here. And
we talked about Cena, and that's not an insult. The people, people passed off as some kind of an insult. It's like if that's what you call an insult, keep insulting me.
And if you get a bald spot, will you actually just give up on it, or are you just going to do what Cena does, have the big floppy comb over? We don't know what's under that hat, to be honest.
I might just do a Billy and just shave it all off, to be honest with you.
I've got a full head of hair, I have witnesses. I just doesn't grow out very well.
Okay.
Yeah. I've every time I go to a hairdresser's with like Jack or something like that, I'll go, yeah, I've got a full head of hair. They actually go and look at it and go, oh, you do? Yes, I do. Witness. There we go. It just grows out really blonde and then just out the side like a Friar Tuck. Which doesn't help with being fat as well. And the final question, after the foundation, what's next? So you've kind of answered that one already. You don't.
Yeah, what would be nice to do? I mean, like me and Omar were a team, but it was more like, you know, like we didn't have a real run as a tag team going for championships or working against other, you know, because I had to deal with the outfit and William Sterling at the time. And then I got caught up with Tucker and then he got caught up with Reese, and then we all kind of end up in the same predicament. And then he was there for my last match at the time, and it was very, very emotional, and it was very emotional for him as well. It feels like we haven't had, we were together, but we weren't really operating as a tag team in the truest sense of the word. So I'd like to revisit that. And like us go for tag team championships, because we never got near that, because we had so much other things to deal with that during that whole period. Not for me to decide, but I would definitely try and coax things in that direction if I could. But again, after Anarchy, it's like what WrestleZone looks like after Anarchy, I don't know. A lot can change. But me and Omar as a tag team would be nice.
We're an hour 45 in, so we're going to speak about Aberdeen Anarchy. So I'll probably have like a bit more, like try and have some more concise thoughts of that out earlier when this goes out today. So it'll be like Wednesday morning, probably. I'll record it Tuesday, and then I'll splice in all the videos and stuff like that, which thanks. I don't know if anyone has ever questioned it, but I did ask permission before I could use WrestleZone videos.
Yeah,
so that's fine. It's all above board. It's all legal.
And also, it's no one's business.
Exactly. Well, nobody's asked, but I'm thinking there's always going to be one person that goes, oh, have you got permission to use that? Because it says on all wrestling videos, you need express permission to use it. It's like, I've asked. I got my blessing and all that. That's how it works. They gave me blessing to use it. Anyway, right. So, Undisputed. No, we're not. I'm faded out. One beer. Jesus Christ. I've got a festival to go to this weekend. I'm going to die. Right, okay, so Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen, May 11th. Doors open at 6 p.m. for VIP, 6:30 for general, 6:15 VIP bell time, 7 p.m. general. Tickets are still available, but I'll assume they are limited at ringsideworld.co.uk. Yeah. Meet and greet packages are already available. Go check out social media and you can find out how to what times to go. Times, I think it's like half two, something like that. Half two to meet Gangrel.
Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, everything's on there. If you're on social media, you're going to see it.
Aye, that's fine. I'll share it a million times because I'm the big WrestleZone bitch, as people
will know. And the last one thing about the WrestleZone feed is it's very good for resharing. And it's very, and the time management of it is really good. It's like, I'm shit, I'm not organized, I'm a waste of fucking time. Whoever's doing that has got their shit together. You know, and things get reshared and stuff, and it's good. So they're on it. So you're going to see it if you follow them. If you have a look, then no, you're going to see it. The show isn't sold out, but that's only because the building's been opened up. It's going to be very fucking busy, and we're still a week out. And so just, but when the time this goes out, if you're wanting to go to the show and you haven't got tickets, you might be too late. If you're not too late, get on it because you might miss out. Because, you know, it's a good sized hall, but it's not that big.
Yeah, record Univision. You can watch it later.
Is that Univision? Is that weekend?
Always Univision night. Aberdeen Anarchy have done it certainly the last 3 years it has been Eurovision night. So I've had to listen to the results on the way home on the radio.
Look at the sacrifices, people. The sacrifices that Billy's making, they come in and see WrestleZone.
I have to sacrifice the one time we were almost winning Eurovision when I got in the door with my pizza from Domino's. The public vote came in and Ukraine won. So I timed it very well to see us lose. So Eurovision night, scrap it, record it. You see, watch the semi-finals Tuesday and Thursday, and then you've seen most of them, so it'll be fine. Anyway, I don't know if you're a Eurovision fan, as you didn't know it was that weekend. I'm going to doubt it.
I just don't fucking care.
Oh, it's utter shit, but it is so entertaining at the same time when you watch it. You're just like, how do people think this is a good idea? But yeah, I'm still there, like, 3 hours later watching it.
Back in the days of watching, you know, like normal terrestrial television, back when that was all you had, then yeah, I did. But now that everything has progressed so far, it's like, I just don't feel compelled to watch Eurovision anymore.
I'll throw a couple songs on the playlist the next day. That's about as far as I'm getting nowadays with it because of bloody wrestling. Anyway, this show, at the moment, as of recording, we've got 5 official matches announced. One that's been offered, which we'll speak about.
Yeah.
We don't know what the pre-show match is. I'm going to assume it's going to involve like Chris Archer and Evan Young somehow because they've got a little thing going. But I don't know. It's not been confirmed. So I can only speculate, and I will speculate. By the time I do the actual record for the Wrestling Podcast, the whole card will probably be announced.
So you know, every single match has been changed.
Oh, did I? Wrestlers as well. Just out of curiosity, just to ask WrestleZone as well. Please stop putting Vago promos out like an hour after I finish recording because it's incredible. That's like 3 shows I've done. I've done the preview, really happy with it, and then like the evening that I've recorded it, a Vago promo goes out. I'm like, do I re-edit it? Do I put it in, or just leave it and make it out of date? I think three times it's happened recently that I've done that. I was all proud of my episode, and then it's always Vago. Always Vago. I don't know if that's on purpose or not. But I think his promo went out today, so that's fine. It'll slip in quite nicely. Anyway, the show, I suppose. As well, speak about it. As I've whinged about about social media, let's talk about the show. Right, so we'll leave your match for a little bit because that's probably the big talking point. So we'll start with our special guest for the evening, Gangrel, teaming with Mickey Vago and Tommy Raiden, take on the team of Judas Grey and the Warriors against low-life entities, Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker. One of the few well, not even a match I predicted, but as soon as Gangrel was announced, I think it was like 20 minutes later, I put on Twitter, yeah, we're going to need some Gangrel and Vago somewhere in this, because that needs to happen. So he's got his import. Very happy.
Well, I was waiting to say, Vago's got another import, but of all the imports, this is the one that probably makes the most sense, and it should be this. So very well predicted. Although Vago over the years has done a lot of Gangrel's offense, so they'll be fighting over who gets to do the offense. He's like, yeah, he's like, I do a lot of your moves. It's like, oh dear, this is awkward.
It's when Vago turns up and he's dressed exactly like Gangrel, and you're just standing across from each other going, well, one of us has got to change.
I'm doing it. I'm Gangrel tonight. I'll do it.
I've got the blouse. I've got the big white blouse on. You just you find something else. Go check the lost and found. Be fine. So Tommy Raiden's in there, which is quite a big match for Tommy as well.
Out with the ladder match from last year, mm-hmm. it'll be the biggest match, and or like it's definitely, if it's not the biggest, it's number two. If it's not number one, and my old pals, Tucker and Dawkins,
yeah,
who were responsible for me being back, because I couldn't be reinstated without Tucker's say-so. And from what I can gather, Tucker had a wee moan, and Dawkins talked him off a cliff and says, some things are more important, Brian, and he actually took the bait and he listened. So thank you, Dawkins, and to a lesser extent, Tucker. And now they're with Judas Gray. So you've got three fashion plates together.
Mm-hmm.
Tucker, Dawkins, and Judas Gray. It's like, I did not predict that. I did not see that coming. But for all of Tucker's tomfoolery and all of Dawkins' shenanigans, Judas Gray is really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's going to play, end up being the one holding that team together, if I'm being honest, because Dawkins has the capability to do it, but he's been led astray by Tucker. Tucker can't do it because he's an idiot. So Gray is going to end up, Gray in one of the biggest matches of his life, not long really becoming somewhat regular to the roster, is now going to find himself pulling the cart for his team, because he's the only one out of those three who's actually switched on. So God knows how that's going to go. Good luck to him, I say, but yeah.
I'm a big fan of Judas, even if he does keep throwing stuff at me. It shows. That's I'm afraid, to be honest, when he comes out at Aberdeen Anarchy, and I'm a little bit afraid. But the fact that he's a big wee Twilighty goth taking on Gangrel, I'm not helping myself here by calling him that. But yeah, it's wee vampire Manny against Gangrel. It's gonna be a good little bit of fun. I'm gonna apologize, Judas. I didn't mean we. It's just the word that came into my head. You are a big strong boy. Judas has really kind of just came in and just made a very quick impression, and to be into that kind of match straight away. It's mirrored Vago's kind of progression, where he came in really quickly. And then he was in the match with Devon, which I don't think Vago will ever admit of those similarities. But there is a little bit of a similar path that these guys have been on already, and then they're all together in one big six man match, which is going to be, it's going to be a lot of fun. I think I'm going to enjoy it anyway. But
it's the very epitome of what WrestleZone is. I think Gangrel is a great fit. He's like, you know, he's like another Scotty Tioti.
Mm.
You know, that's a good fit. You know, like Devon was a good fit, and the Hurricane was a good fit. Duggan was the best fit. It's like Duggan is still like the, because that pop was fucking mental. They were loud. They were loud. It's never been that loud again, in my opinion. So yeah, six-man tag, good times. I'm predicting a win for Tommy, Vago, and Gangrel, unless Judas Grey really, really just throws this knocks out the park for his team, because he's going to have to be the one doing it if they're going to win.
Yeah, I'm not going to do predictions because I feel like I jinx people, but I made sure to put Vago's match in first when we're doing this preview because I almost forgot it last time I did a video about WrestleZone. So we will. So it's definitely in there, Vago, this time. I have remembered. I don't know how I keep forgetting his matches. I think there's some sort of subconscious jealousy about the mosh pit that's making me just forget him. It's got me advertised.
No, Vago's just your natural enemy now, but you just don't want to talk about it.
That's it. It's like outwardly, it's definitely Ted, but inwardly, it's actually Vago.
Yes.
So I've also got... Well, speaking of people that you've teamed with, what up? We weren't, but I'm going to say that just for the segue for this particular match.
Okay, we'll do that anyway. That's fine.
We've got a ladder match. We've got TV's Omar Mohammed taking on Captain Alan Sterling. The prizes on offer are Omar's Shivani or Shivani Alan's Battle Cap.
Yeah. Omar took that on, took his hat with him on holiday. And it almost never made it back in the plane, from what I was being told. I almost lost that. It's like, well, why have you got with you on holiday in the first place? Anyway, Alan Sterling has went on record. It says he doesn't even know what ladders are for. So I don't know how he's going to win this match. So Omar wins.
Which is baffling, because he's been in one of the best. One of the best ladder matches in Aberdeen Anarchy history. I think it was the sixth man, wasn't it?
It's mental. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, no, he does. But this incarnation of Alan Sterling has had his memory banks just wiped, and now he's just rebooted, and he's starting fresh as Captain Alan, and nothing else before means anything. And I know I'm biased. I'm not going to pretend that I'm not biased. Of course I'm biased. Of course I want Omar to win. He's my guy. But one of the participants in a ladder matches, what a record, said he doesn't know what a ladder is for, so how is he going to win? I don't know. It's like, and they're fighting for a hat, which Alan really shouldn't have, and a Shivani, which is very important to Omar's heritage and culture, and Alan just thinks it looks nice and calls it a Shivani money. This is where we are, people. This is where we are now.
We're through the looking glass.
We are the looking glass.
I don't know what to expect from that match, other than being thoroughly sports entertained. That's going to be a guarantee. We've got the tag team match, tag team titles on the line with my best pal, Ted O'Keefe and Murphy. They will be defending against Flippy and Drippy, Connor Malloy and Ronan King. Now, we've talked good things about Connor and Ronan, but together they are Flippy and Drippy. Flippy in Drippy. A bit of mixed fortunes as a tag team so far. They knocked off Aspen and Caleb at Granite City Showdown, and then they lost in a handicap match to Aspen at Regal Rumble. So, you know, not great.
Yeah, I mean, they won in January, but like it almost became like a backdrop for where we are now. We're talking about Caleb and Aspen later on, but it's like Caleb and Aspen had some issues in January, and we came out of that match and no one was really talking about the fact that Flippy and Drippy won. People were talking about the fact that Caleb and Aspen had a wee bit of a malfunction at the junction, and he spoke about the handicap match, and Ronan was unsuccessful against Aspen and Peterhead. Connor was unsuccessful against Killer Peterhead. It's like it feels like they formed this team and they've been really impressive without really moving the needle. And if they don't move the needle at Anarchy, I think they're going to slide down the card a little bit. The outfit are... the outfit was chugging along nicely, but I mean, they weren't making any real waves. And then the foundation cast stones at them, and then they stepped up, and everything's intertwined, because because of what happened there, they had a pot shot at the outfit, not thinking that the outfit would stand up for themselves, and they did. And then the long-term ramifications were Zach Dynamite loses the Tri-Counties Championship, the Foundation Boys, Evans and Riley lose tag team championships, which then led to them doing what they've done, led to the point where I've now been reinstated. So if anything, like an extra thank you has to go to the outfit for me. And I came out, Ellen, wearing the outfit t-shirt to prove a point, because this all happened because they lost their championships and they couldn't handle it because they behaved like children. And there's three grown men, three of the most talented individuals in this country right now, bar none. And they're behaving like kids, and it's fucking embarrassing. Like, you're actually embarrassing yourself. So I would love the outfit to retain here. And as a matter of fact, I think they're going to. I just flipping drippy, or they're really good at social media, and they're talking a good game, but I just don't think it's their time yet. I just don't. I just can't see it ending for the outfit anytime soon. Been wrong before. I don't know where you're taking it is, but that's mine.
I think for me, there's always the Dino factor. Even though he's injured, even though I put him as my five predictions for the Regal Rumble, he is injured. But it's been announced that that's under the Freebird rule. So there's always a chance, slim maybe, that they're not, that Flippy and Drippy won't even face Ted O'Keefe and Murphy. They'll face Dino and Murphy, which is a different beast entirely, different dynamic. Or even Ted O'Keefe and Dino, which they've got a bit of a longer chemistry as a tag team. So there's always that kind of Dino factor. Like I say, he's injured. He might not be back by the time that Anarchy rolls around, but there's always that kind of question mark there for it that they haven't utilized yet because of the injury that I'm always just intrigued by if we're going to get Dino involved. I like Connor. I like Ronan. I love to see him win tag titles. That would be true. But I also understand what you're saying about and maybe it's a bit too early in the day for them to be there with the tag titles. But again, heart and brain, you know, all kind of working against each other when it comes to what I want and what I think, you know.
Yeah, that's the thing. Often there are two different things. What you want and what you think is going to happen are often not the same thing. I think it'll be a hell of a match. We saw them in singles matches together, and Ellen, little taster, but the real test is 2-on-2 titles on the line, and not just that. It's Anarchy. It's gonna be busy in there. You know, there's gonna be that need to kind of perform at a high level or compete at a high level. And I worry a little bit that because it's Anarchy and it's building up as a bigger show, which it is a bigger show, and that need to impress, I just think Connor and Ronan are going to take chances that they don't need to take because they feel the need to. And I think Murphy and Ted are going to play it a little more cautious and a little more sensible, and I think that might be the key. But again, we both could be wrong completely. I just don't know.
I mean, last year, Anarchy Ronan stabbed Damien and almost killed himself on a shooting star press. So, you know, he's got form
I know about it after the fact, and I saw it after the fact, and it was in my blood run cold.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So before we talk about the Where It Takes All match, we'll go with the match that has been kind of, again, offered. That was the phrase I'm using for this because it's not been official. There's no graphic out for it yet, as far as I'm aware. As Air Miles' final match, his 10-year wrestling career is coming to a close, and he's been offered the chance to face Alex Webb in a 1-on-1 match at Aberdeen Anarchy, which we got a little preview of that at the Regal Rumble when they entered 1 and 2. I think that's going to be like a kind of bittersweet match to watch, because I've spoken to Miles a couple times on the podcast. I've seen him wrestle a few times up here, not just for WrestleZone. So I've seen him about for a long time, and I've enjoyed the Fair City Saints probably certainly at one point very recently, probably one of the top three teams in the country, tag teams in the country. So to see them kind of go face to face, one on one for, I don't know, the first time in probably about 8 years or something like that, they've actually wrestled each other properly in a singles match. Yeah, it's going to be a bit of a bittersweet one to watch. And I mean, I don't know what your feelings are with Miles. I think they were properly getting going in WrestleZone as you were going out of WrestleZone. But yeah, what are your thoughts on this one?
I agree with what you said. Like one of the best teams in Scotland is. If you had a list of the best teams in Scotland and the Fair City Saints weren't on your list, then you're either a liar or you're not paying attention, because they should be, because they were. Shame, I can't say that they are, because apparently Miles is hanging up. We say that, everyone retires. Hi. You know, I've just came back. Different situation. I mean, I had to go versus him. This is his decision to go. I think, without getting too much into it, I think some people elsewhere treated him badly. And then for the people who know what I'm talking about, they know how it's like fuck you for doing that to him, because Miles is a good person and a really good talent. So it's nice. You say it's bittersweet, and you're right. But you know, for as opposed to Miles just kind of quietly disappearing, what a nice way to go out.
Mm-hmm.
Wrestling his wrestling brother. Yeah, wrestling
son.
Alex Webb. Yeah, you know, and it just feels like the right way to go. It feels like and also doing it at Anarchy, and you know, and the start of that Rumble with those two, was watching it back was so much fun, man. I love that. Mm-hmm. It was great. So I think Miles against Webb feels like an odd match, but when you know why it's happening and you put it in the context, it's actually the right match.
Mm-hmm. This is gonna be a weird one to watch. Alex Webb, of course, YouTube superstar himself.
Yes.
Which I love his videos. It sounds sad. It's like when he just puts a lot of effort into them. But hopefully we get to see him still up in the Northeast. Whether it's going after singles championships, I think we can see a little bit more of Alex Webb. But I'm glad to see Miles has made it up here and got a good reaction from people, because he's a guy that I'd seen a number of years in other places, and I'm glad that he's getting the recognition and. In front of, probably since the Beach Ballroom anyway, certainly one of the biggest crowds that WrestleZone is going to have, and he gets to do that in front of that kind of big crowd in the Rich Energy Arena as well. So that seems maybe a bit of a sad one to watch, but you know, take it as it is, and never say never, and all that kind of stuff.
I will be sure to tell him on the night, no matter what happens, I'll see you back at some point, because they'll come back.
Yeah.
So like he has every intention. He's not lying to himself. He's walking away. Right now he's telling the truth, but we all come back. And if he wants to come back, he's more than welcome, because he's liked by everyone. So mm-hmm. And he's great in the ring.
Yeah.
We spoke about, like, it feels like hours ago. I guess it was almost 2 hours ago now. We spoke about Caleb.
Yeah.
And like, and also being like humble and nice guy. That's Miles. Mm-hmm. Like, Miles is that kind of a guy. And there's lots of people in Scottish wrestling that I just hear stuff and I just dust my head in for various reasons. And a lot of it's because I'm a grumpy bastard, but a lot of it is because I actually feel that, you know, God, people behave in a certain way. It's hard losing someone like Miles, because we can't afford to lose people like him. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I hope he comes back.
I mean, just to say a little piece about Miles is when he was celebrating 10 years wrestling this year, he contacted me asking, do you want to have a chat about it? Kind of thing. I don't often have people approach me to be on the podcast. It's usually me doing it to them. And I like that he came, he approached me going, I'm celebrating 10 years. Would you like to speak about it? Absolutely. Let's book an afternoon in and we'll get a big chat in. And we did. It was a good fun chat, and he is humble about his abilities, much like Caleb is, as we've discussed. So he's one of the good ones that we're gonna say goodbye for a period, hopefully not for as long as he's intending. Undisputed Wrestling Championship, Tri-Counties Championship, winner takes all, lost by Aspen, the Undisputed Champion, taking on the Tri-Counties Champion and Regal Rumble winner, Caleb Valhalla. In a match that has divided this household once again, happened last year as well. Unfortunately, it's divided this household, but again, it's that head and heart thing. My heart wants Aspen to retain, obviously, and be champion forever. When he actually is in this match on this day, he matches your record for the Undisputed Wrestling Zone Championship of 525 days.
Oh, wow.
And then but my brain goes, I would love to see Caleb win it. Because, again, not just because he's a nice guy, because he's just everything that you probably want from a wrestler as well. So, yeah, I am going to be head in hands, probably crying after that particular match. Because I now just have the emotion levels of a teenager, it seems, at wrestling shows. Yeah, we saw this last year. It was very hard hitting. I think this year there's going to be a bit of emotional level added to it because Skull Brawl is a very active thing. I don't know. It's going to be one I'm just going to watch from my head and hands and just hope I don't know. I don't even know who really I want to win because of the whole head and heart thing. So I'm just going to watch it and just that's it. That's pretty much all I can really say about it.
Yeah, I mean Skull Brawl was really something that was going on in Discovery Wrestling, and it's kind of bled into WrestleZone, and it's now bled into TNT, and it's just fun. I'd say about wrestling can be fun. I mean, even if it's two heavyweights like Aspen and Caleb, it can still be fun. This match is WrestleMania 6. It's IC champ versus Evolved champ. It's Hogan versus Warrior. And we don't talk about the last one because that belt doesn't mean anything. We know we talk about this because this is actually important, okay? A part of me just can't see. Aspen wasn't lucky last year to retain. So it's saying lucky is disrespectful.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, like it was so close that at the end of the match, we had a winner and a loser, and the winner didn't look like a winner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I just it's a lot to ask someone to do that again when you know in their head they're probably thinking Anna? Yeah, because I mean they were essentially carried out last year, right, weren't they?
Pretty much, yeah. I think Eagle was on the scene and all that, and yeah.
Like here's your winner and still undisputed champion as he gets carried out. Are you gonna do that again and still walk out champion? I mean, of course he can. If anyone can, it's going to be Aspen. But really, I don't know. If that was me, and obviously he's not me, so it's not fair for me to say what he's thinking. But if that was me, I'd be panicking.
Yeah,
it's like God, I got to do this again. I mean, last year I was carried out, and now I need to do it again, and. Now we've got the added factor of having two championships involved. We've got the added factor of Anarchy this year being much bigger than last year. and you think about the confidence built in a man who's now won 2 Rumbles in a row and now has headlined Anarchy 2 years in a row. I mean that's like, you know, that's, you know, confidence level through the roof. So if it's ever going to happen for Caleb, this could be it. No guarantee that it's going to be it, because the guy in front of him is Aston Faith. Sorry, mm-hmm. Lost by Aston. He didn't like call me Faith anymore. I still find that weird. I can't not call him Aston Faith. Lost by Aston.
I think I would have to double check, but I think this is possibly Aston will be the first person to have 3 main events in a row. I don't know. I would have to double check. I don't know if that would be correct. I know. Oh no, that's a lie. You did 3 main events in a row.
I did. I had Joe Coffey.
Joe Coffey, Crusher Crave, and Sean Johnson. So again, another mirroring thing that you can sympathise with, that you've had that kind of 3 in a row as well. But yeah, so that's, I don't know.
It's really hard. It's, and again, I know it's like it's different. Different era and a different situation, a different context, but you know, like, okay, I'm here again, and I'm here again, here again, and it's like, fuck, it gets fucking hard. Mm-hmm. It does get hard, yeah. You know? And sometimes, like, it becomes, it's no longer your time through no fault of your own. It's just hard,
mm-hmm.
And yeah, Aspen might be the guy to buck the trend. And again, like, if anyone can do all the things that we're talking about, it can be him.
Yeah.
It's just, we've just got this now, and I really hope if someone wins peace so I can watch the match.
get on.
My takeaway from it.
Get on Martin's health plan and get into Albine Hospital. That's the way to go.
Yes.
You watch it. Watch that, it on a live feed.
That's a good idea.
So finally, we'll speak. We don't know what the pre-show match is. Like I said, I'm assuming it's something to do with Archer and Young, but we don't know. So I'll leave that.
Go against Billy, against Ted in a triple threat.
5 stars. There you go.
5 stars. 6 stars at Tokyo Dome, but 5 stars at Anarchy.
7 at the ballroom. That's
7 in the ballroom.
Is your match, of course. So we've kind of touched upon it throughout the episode, throughout the two hours and 20 minutes that we've 22 hours 15 we've been on for.
Damn it.
I think it's again longest episode of the season. Of course it is. Is Sterling Oil, William Sterling, Damien, Scotty Swift taking on the Foundation of the Future, Zach Dynamite, Ryan Riley, and Bruiser Brad Evans. Not to forget, Richard R. Russell will be in the corner of Sterling Oil. We don't know if Foundation of the Future are gonna string someone to be in their corner. You've said that you possibly will record something to maybe talk a little bit more in depth about this particular match, but
yeah,
for what it is right now, your initial thoughts.
If you even as recently as like, I don't know, like a month ago, it was, oh, you're going to be back at Anarchy, okay, yeah, oh, you're teaming up with William Sterling and Damien, and you're going to be Sterling Oil, very good. Oh, and Russell's coming back. Yeah. So who are we wrestling? Oh, Foundation of the Future. And I called it, so like you're speaking at your arse. I've said before about, you know, no DQ and street fight matches make sense in my head for some reason. They make sense to me. Sometimes more than just a traditional match, depending on who you're against. It's, you know, had the over 18 shows and had about run outs with Halloween Brawl and no DQ with Andy Weld and no DQ with Crusher Crave, and it's like having the ability to almost like have the shackles taken off you, and there's a little more freedom being there with a team of 2 guys that made my life really difficult for a long time. It was weird. Me and Damien have been okay for a couple of years now. It took us a while to get there. Me and Sterling, it's been complicated. Me and Russell don't like each other, so that's awkward. I don't know, but I mean, I spoke a lot about it before. We talk about a great wrestling match. You're talking about Aaron Miles against Alex Webb. You're going to get a great wrestling match there. You're going to get a fucking clusterfuck here. It's going to be a clusterfuck. And I make no apologies towards. No apologies to the sweet science of wrestling for this one. It's just gonna be, a goddamn war zone. Until one team is declared the winner, and hopefully it's us. Sterling Oil, like what?
So yeah, that's, I think we'll sum it up there. Just for time and what have you, but yeah. So I'll correct myself. Doors open 5:30 p.m. for VIP ticket. If you turn up at 6, you'll be really far back. And 6:30 p.m. for general ticket holders. May 11th, Aberdeen Anarchy. Get your ticket at ringsideworld.co.uk if you still can. I will be there. I have my ticket in hand. We could get childcare that night because so Kelly will be at home, so she'll be waiting very feverishly. On Facebook, waiting for the announcement, or I'll FaceTime her when if Aspen wins. Just go, yeah. But you know, it'll be a fun night nonetheless. So I can't wait. I can't wait to see you back, Scotty Swift, back in the WrestleZone ring officially. It's gonna be a good time, and this has been another very long tangent fueled. Like I said, no notes, and we've talked about everything in life for 2.5 hours.
No notes between us. No notes whatsoever. I'm happy that I'm back. I'm happy that I get to. I'm very fortunate. I get to come back and be a part of something that's, you know, I guess like a featured match. When the depth, the talent is so strong, it seems to get younger and younger, and like there's still a place for me to do something, which is nice. I will say I'll keep an eye out for you, but I might be busy. I don't know. I'll try and wave to you if I get the chance.
Right,
but I don't
fair.
Make any promises.
Just don't throw anything at me. That'd be nice.
Yeah. I will. If it kicks off, I will do my best to deflect any projectiles or bodies in your direction. I'll do what I can. Good to speak to you again. Excited for what's coming up. To answer Callum, I don't know what that is. Get me and Omer to tag team, break out the Usher winning, because it's just been hanging up there for years now, not getting used. It's annoying me now. It's actually quite depressing, and I like how I look in it. So let's get it back on. Let's get that going. Well, it's been fun. Thank you, Billy. It's always a pleasure. Yep. And we'll do number 7, and it'll be another Ghostbusters related title that won't make any sense until you make it make sense.
That's exactly it. It'll all work itself out. But yeah. Do you want to plug your social medias, or do you just want people to leave you alone?
Oh, yeah, I want to leave me alone. we go on Facebook and Twitter, put on Scotty Swift, you're going to find it. I mean, the guy in the picture can have red hair. Am I going to have red hair, Anarchy? That's for you to find out, Billy. You can agonize over that until the day that, oh my God, is it going to be white and grey? Oh my God, what's going to happen? Just like the last time. You will find out on a night how I'm going to look. Might look different. Might look the same. Might be wearing something different. That's all I'm saying. Good times. Until someone gets hurt.
Me agonize about a really tiny thing that makes no difference to the real world. that does not sound like me at all. But we'll sign off now.
About proper autism.
You know what? It's not even funny, to be honest. My brother's got autism and he's got learning difficulties. I'm fairly certain I'm somewhere in that spectrum as well when it comes to that sort of shit.
No, we spoke about this, how we're all on the spectrum.
Oh, well, we all are.
Of course we are. Let's not lie to ourselves. Of course we are.
Oh, no.
We're
definitely somewhere on there. Like, I'm going to sit and wait for this episode to load, even though it's 10:30 at night. Well, why? Just do it tomorrow. Anyway, this has been another fantastic long episode of the SWN podcast. I think we've probably going to hit, we must have hit 10 hours by now in total. We must be starting to rock towards a dirty dozen of hours of
episode. Oh yeah, we're probably overall about 12 hours now, and we still haven't spoken about the Training Academy single time. It's like, you know what? Let's never talk about it. As just like an ongoing rib. Let's never talk about it.
Yeah, okay, we'll go then. But no, perfect. Yeah, thank you very much for your time.
Bye-bye.